What is the purpose of life? It's a huge question, but inevitably we all ask it. We will have this existential crisis at some late night after watching a whole bunch of cat videos. What is going on in my life? Am I doing it right? When my end comes to me, will I reflect upon my life and say, hey, that was a good life? This possibly could be the most important question we ever ask ourselves. Erik Erikson basically gave us a step-by-step guide on how to live the best life possible. I love this stuff. I'm Professor Alan Girding, and I love psychology. Today, we're going to talk all about the life and theory of Erik Erikson, the king of the identity crisis. Long story short, he said, hey, you want to know yourself, and the better you know yourself, the better the life you will have. Five things we want to cover today, each of which has a little bit of girth to it. We're going to talk about the life of Erikson, the eight psychosocial stages. That's the theory for which he's famous. Basic weaknesses, too. Got to be careful of that, because life is a balance, and if you're unbalanced, well, you're weak. Then we're going to talk about Erikson's tools. What did he do when he was doing therapy or assessing or researching? And speaking of research, we're going to end up talking about the research on Erikson. How accurate was he? Plot spoiler, he was very accurate. We're going to start with the life of Erikson. The life of Erikson was a life of an identity crisis.
Who am I? I don't know.
Even his name. Erik Hamburger Erikson, born Erik Solomonsen. Why is his name different? What's with the name change? Did he change it when he got married? No! It all starts in Frankfurt, Germany, with his father, kind of? He didn't know who his father was, and that's the main point of Erikson. Who was his dad? He never knew. Why? Because of his mother. She was a Danish mother from a wealthy Jewish family, and she got married to a groom who disappeared only hours after the wedding. Maybe you've heard of cold feet before a wedding, but maybe this was a case of cold feet after the wedding, so severe that he just mic dropped, said, I'm out of here, and poofed, disappeared. But not just from his wife, from everybody. No one knows where this dude went. Is there murder going on? Nobody knows. Very mysterious. But perhaps even more mysterious is that after the wedding, she ended up pregnant. Pregnant with a mystery man.
Yeah, baby! Yeah.
Oh, no one knows who the father of this baby was. She just one day's like, hey, I'm all pregnant. And that was a big no-no back then. Some people still consider it a no-no. Hey, you won't get judgment from me, Professor Alan Girding. But her family sent her to live in Germany, saying, hey, you know what? In Denmark, we don't want this shameful pregnancy from some mystery man. We like people to get married here, so we're sending you to Germany to live a shameful life. She went to Germany, and she married her pediatrician, Dr. Theodor Hamburger.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
So Erik Erikson's growing up, but he had this huge identity crisis. He felt like he couldn't fit in. The dad that was acting like his dad wasn't actually his dad at all. Like,
Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father.
He told me enough. He told me you killed him.
No, I
am not your father. But he couldn't even fit in school. Why? Well, he was a Jewish kid, even though he considered himself German, being raised in Germany. Problem is, the Germans rejected him because his mother and stepfather were Jewish.
All you ever do is call me names and rip on me for being Jewish.
Kyle, when have I ever ripped on you for being a Jew?
Oh yeah? Well, you're a stupid Jew.
You're a Jew.
Shut your goddamn Jew mouth!
Good job, Jew.
Jews.
Shut up, Jew.
You're Jewish.
Dude is Jewish.
Jew.
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 I told you Jewish people don't have rhythm.
F*** off, Carmen!
Okay, except maybe for that one time.
But then the Jewish people didn't accept him either. Why? Why couldn't he hang out with the Jews? Well, he was this tall, blonde, Nordic-looking dude. Some type of Viking. Hey, we don't look like Vikings. Get out of here, you non-Jewish-looking person. He couldn't fit in anywhere. A total social reject. Years later, his daughter, Platzweiler, who eventually got married and had a daughter, said, "My father suffered terribly from the sense that his real father had abandoned him and had never cared to know him. He struggled with a depressive tendency all his life." Written by Erikson's daughter in a book by the name of In the Shadow of Fame. Because Erik Erikson is one of the most famous people in the history of psychology, so famous that this book is a good read. It's about his daughter talking all about how she grew up with this amazing man. Anywho, let's go on with the story. What happened to Erikson? Well, he didn't do too well in school. Still never really had these good friends. But he always doodled in notebooks, was always painting. He was an artiste. So he decided he'd walk the earth.
What you mean walk the earth?
You know, like Kane in Kung Fu. Walk from place to place, meet people, get in adventures.
Eventually he ended up in Vienna, Austria, where they needed an art teacher in an elementary school. At age 25, he was offered to teach at Sigmund Freud Elementary School. Now, it wasn't actually called Sigmund Freud Elementary School, but let me explain something really quickly. Sigmund Freud was so famous, people would move their families to Vienna so that their family members could have Sigmund Freud as their clinician. So many wealthy families did this that Vienna had a boom to their economy and a slight boom to their population. So many new families were there, they needed another school. There was a whole elementary school created for the children of Sigmund Freud's clients. And they needed an art teacher, and that art teacher, Erik Erikson. Erik Erikson was fascinated, drawn to Sigmund Freud naturally as this powerful father figure. So he trained in psychoanalysis with Anna Freud. What? Who's Anna Freud? Sigmund Freud's daughter. They had sessions almost daily for 3 years. And these therapy sessions cost $7 a month. Now, $7 a month doesn't sound like much money. It was definitely more money back then, but still not a whole bunch of money. It was kind of the deal of him working at Freud Elementary. Erikson and Anna's interest as they were working together grew into fascination with child psychology. And eventually he meets Joan Searson, Canadian-born artist and dancer, and he fell in love with her. So much so, he got her pregnant. What? Problem? She's not Jewish. And if she's not Jewish, well, I can't marry her. I'm a Jew. Jews have to marry Jews. Erikson's close friends and family members said, "Hey, Erik, you should marry this woman for a few reasons. One, you love her. Two, she's El Prego. Three, you're constantly complaining about how you didn't know your father, and you would be a damn hypocrite not to marry this woman, forcing your child to be raised without a dad or knowing their father, because that's all you bitch about all the time, Erikson. Why don't you start being a solution instead of the problem? Plus, again, one, you love her. Two, she's pregnant. Get with the program." So he did. He married her, and it took 3 weddings. They had a justice of the peace type of wedding where they just went to the courtroom to get it done and over with. But then they had to have a Jewish wedding and they had to have a Christian wedding. Oh man, how was the relationship? Supposedly, it was an amazing marriage. Anyone who knew Erik Erikson also knew Joan Searson. The two lives were so intertwined romantically, functionally, pragmatically. Everyone said, he would have been nothing without Joan. So romantic. Let's go on with the story. In 1933, they moved to Boston due to the Nazis, as many people did. He set up a private practice specializing in the treatment of children. And he was affiliated with Henry Murray's Harvard Clinic, so he's working near Harvard with some Harvard professors, serving on the Diagnostic Council, applying the psychoanalysis he learned with Anna Freud. Now, keep in mind, he doesn't have a formal education. So he decided, you know what? I'm going to get a formal education at Harvard since I have some ins. But he failed his first course at Harvard and said, this isn't for me. I don't need a formal academic training. This isn't as satisfying as what I've already learned through walking the earth, through working with Anna Freud. I'm out of here. So he never earned his doctorate. But yet, he still did research. Yes, he did formalized research, unlike a lot of his predecessors. He collaborated with Yale anthropologists to study child-rearing practices of Sioux Indians. So why was he researching Sioux Indians? He researched a whole bunch of different cultures because he wanted to make sure the theories and practice he was using and growing were universally acceptable, not just specific to one microculture. He wanted to make sure these apply to all men, women, children, of everyone of the world. He wanted to study as broad as possible, as diverse as possible. One big motivator for all this broad research is that he noticed that there are plenty of psychological symptoms that can't be explained by Freudian theory. What's the solution then? And he came with this conclusion that people who didn't really seem to have a strong identity seemed to be having severe symptoms. He originally called this identity confusion. He explained so many psychological problems with this idea of identity confusion, including shell shock, or as we know it nowadays, PTSD. And he described World War II veterans and their issues as having this. Think about it. It's basically dual lives. Are you just an average citizen going about your business? Or are you some badass soldier whose job is to follow orders and kill people en masse, the enemy, seeing your fellow comrades die in battle? This isn't an everyday thing. So who are you? Are you this average citizen? Or are you a soldier living a soldier's life? A weapon for the world. And this dual identity, like Batman versus Bruce Wayne, can add to a whole bunch of problems. Believe it or not, this is still true to this day. We understand that to help someone with post-traumatic stress disorder, we have to let them know that there is room for a blended identity of being both a typical citizen and a soldier. 1950, Erikson joined a treatment facility for emotionally disturbed adolescents. In 1960, he ended up being a professor at Harvard University. He failed his first class at Harvard. Now he's teaching at Harvard. In 1970, he retired. In 1986, he publishes a book about old age. He was a celebrated man. We love him. I love him because I love psychology. I love his theory. Arguably, the most important theory anyone learns. Because this is the psychosocial stages of personality. 8 stages, each of which forces us into a crisis. And we solve this crisis either in a syntonic, healthy way or a dystonic, unhealthy way. Think of it as celebrity deathmatch, if you've ever seen that show. 2 opponents enter arena, but only one leaves Thunderdome style. So this crisis is a battle between 2 virtues, and which virtue will win? Will trust win or will mistrust win? Only time will tell. There's 8 of these stages. The first 4 stages are radically different than the last 4 stages, because you have to keep in mind, Erik Erikson believed that his theory was totally in line with Freud's theory. In fact, the reason he called them the psychosocial stages is he believed his theories were an extension of Freud's psychosexual stages. So psychosocial is an homage to psychosexual. But the last 4 stages are what he considered his extensions. Realistically, he expanded on the first 4 as well. But the first 4 are influenced by the environment, typically the parents and how the parents raise the child. But once the parents are done with their influence, you have the last 4 stages. And if it's not up to the parents, who's it up to? It's up to you. Those are influenced by the individual. It's time to learn some vocabulary terms before we get into the nitty-gritty details of these 8 psychosocial stages. First of all, Erikson emphasized its nature and nurture. To explain this, he used the term the epigenetic principle of maturation, the idea that human development is governed by a sequence of stages that depend on genetic factors. He's going to emphasize a lot of environmental situations, the parents doing this, the parents doing that. That is all nurture. But he wanted to make sure that he said, yeah, genetics are important too. Boom, epigenetic principle of maturation. He also used the term crisis, meaning a turning point faced at each developmental stage. This is going to be this battle of virtues of which I previously spoke. Then we have the basic strengths. These are the virtues. If the healthy virtue wins, you are deemed to have a basic strength that you carry with you. We're talking about hope, will, purpose, competence, fidelity, love, care, wisdom. Ha! Huh? My goodness. These motivating characteristics and beliefs that derive from the satisfactory resolution of the crisis at each developmental stage. One thing to keep in mind about these basic strengths is one basic strength can't come to be until the previous basic strength is acquired. You can't skip steps, is what this is saying. You can't do one, then three, then two, then eight. It has to be in order. I'm going to tell you each of these eight stages quickly right now. But then we're going to spend a majority of this video going into the details for each of these eight stages, including their basic strengths. Stage one is trust versus mistrust. When you're born, you can't do much. You got to get a sense of trust, because if you don't trust people, it means you're dying as a baby. You got to rely on people to feed you, to change you, to make sure that you, as this crawling, crying grub worm that urinates and pukes all over the place, lives. Eventually start moving and walking around. Will you be able to get a sense of autonomy, that you're in control of where you go? Autonomy who? Autonomy. What's autonomy? It's believing that you're the master of your own destiny. Or do you have this sense of doubt and shame? What happens in the arena in round three? Into the ring enters initiative versus guilt. Do you have a sense of initiative? Do you do what you need to do? Or do you just sit around feeling guilty about not doing the things you're supposed to do? Then we have industry versus inferiority. Some people call industry industriousness. How well do you do the things you do? Do you get that A, or are you satisfied with a B? Or do you just sit there feeling inferior, saying, I'm gonna get the D or F. Yeah, that's me, because I suck. Those are the first four stages. A big deal, because they're expansions on Freudian's theory. They're up to the parents, but now you're on your own. You have to figure out who the heck you are in stage five. Identity cohesion versus role confusion. Do you know who you are? And once you know who you are, then maybe you can find someone else. And that comes into intimacy versus isolation. Can you love someone? Or are you that lone wolf? No one can understand me. Isolation time, baby. Once you find someone, can you have kids and live a life of generativity? Generativity is a made-up word by Erik Erikson, the root word being generous, thinking of others. Or do you have this stagnation, this idea that nothing is moving, that nothing has a point? Finally, the last stage in late adulthood is gonna be ego integrity versus despair. You reflect upon your life. Was it a good life? Or were you a piece of poop worth nothing but flushing? And now you feel despair. Oh my, there you have the brilliant eight psychosocial stages. But when do they occur? How do they succeed? What are the basic strengths? We're gonna go over all of this. Not then, because that was a preview. Now it's time to get into the details. Stage one. Happens at birth to age one. The two virtues battling it out here, pew, pew, trust versus mistrust. And remember, as we go over these, I want you to ask yourself, do you have a sense of trust, or do you have this pervasive sense of mistrust where anytime you walk outside of your home, you're constantly looking over your shoulder? I believe most of you listening to this right now probably have a strong sense of trust, because we don't live in the world of the walking dead, where every moment is a battle for survival. When you bump into a stranger, you're not thinking, who are you? Are you gonna eat me, kill me? Are you gonna steal everything I own? Can I trust you? You gotta answer some questions and go through some tests before I can stop looking over my shoulder at you to make sure you're not gonna stab me in the back. But how do we make sure that we have a sense of trust? Remember, this is up to the parents, so the infants at this time must rely on others for care. Again, this is very similar to Freud's oral stage. And Freud said there's a balance to be had here. Don't give the baby too much oral satisfaction, because the baby could be fixated. Or don't deprive the baby of any oral satisfaction, otherwise the baby will get stuck in this stage. Erikson said it's much simpler than this. The infants need consistent and dependable care. So if the baby's hungry, feed the baby. If the baby's dirty, change the baby. Baby's crying? Hold the ding dang baby. It's that simple. Feed, change, hold. Take care of this little grub, and that baby will get a sense of trust. However, if you neglect that baby, let it cry, let it stay hungry, rolling around in its own filth, well then it could develop a sense of mistrust. And this sense of mistrust can last potentially for life. And research is going to show that this is true. Think about that. That if you are not cared for from the time you were born to 1 year of age, this is such a sensitive stage to garner this sense of trust of humanity that can last the rest of your life. So it's so important that if you have a child, make sure you're meeting that child's needs. Now, if you do, not only does this baby get a sense of trust, but you get the basic strength. Because we said we talk about basic strengths, and this basic strength is hope. A belief that our desires will be satisfied. Do you have hope? Do you believe that good stuff is coming and you can trust society? Chances are, if you do, you have a strong sense of trust. But what about after age one? What happens then? Welcome to stage two, autonomy versus shame and doubt, age 1 to 3 years of age. What the heck is autonomy? Autonomy is defined in a bunch of different ways by a bunch of different theorists, but Professor Girding's definition of autonomy seems to fit all those different theories, and that simply said is being the master of your own destiny. Do you believe you are in charge of what happens to your life? And what can children start doing at age of one that they weren't really doing before? Yeah, they start using a single word here or there, but I'm talking about walking. And if you want that baby to go ahead and get a sense that they're a master of their own destiny and avoid having this lifelong doubt that plagues them, you gotta let them walk. Let them explore their environment. Children are discovering their own independence as they walk. They want to know what's around that corner. Do you let them walk around the corner? Or do you overly restrain them? Erikson argued that this stage is very similar to Freud's anal stage. It's all about the acquisition of power. Erikson said, well, it's not so much about what you do with your anus on the toilet. It's actually about exploring your environment. Do you have this sense of power that you can solve the mystery of what's around that corner on your own, with your own feet, with your own legs? So those given the opportunity to experience independence will gain a sense of autonomy. But those children that are overly restrained or punished harshly will develop shame or doubt. Now, it's still pretty simple. Stage one, feed the kid, change the kid, make sure the kid's alive. In this stage, let the kid walk, let the kid explore. I don't mean let the kid explore dangerous areas.
Don't let him go on the road, Lord!
Get him, Lord! Get the baby! Get the baby! Get the baby!
If your toddler is walking out the front door, don't just say, hey, have fun, don't get eaten by wolves. No, follow the baby. Make sure that kid's not getting hurt, but let the baby lead. This is something very romantic. Think about it. That simple ability to explore where you want to explore gives us the foundation that we are in charge of our destiny. And that gives us the sense of will. The determination to exercise freedom of choice and self-restraint in the face of society's demands.
Freedom of choice! What you got? Freedom of choice!
You have the ability to walk away or walk towards something. You have free will, autonomy. It's a beautiful thing. Now, the first two stages are pretty simple for parenting. Feed the kid, let the kid walk. But now we get into more of a balancing act, and this is stage three. 3 to 6 years of age with initiative versus guilt. At 3 to 6 years of age, you start giving the child some responsibilities. It's time for you to start learning how to pick up your Legos on your own. In fact, at age 5 and 6, you're looking at preschool and kindergarten. They have to interact and they have to follow rules, and they're given very simple tasks that they're supposed to follow, and you want to do it right. It's a balance. A sense of accomplishment leads to initiative, whereas feelings of guilt can emerge if the child is made to feel too anxious or irresponsible. So give them things to do, but don't give them too much. Don't tell your 4-year-old, hey, it's April, which means those taxes are due, so I need you to do our taxes. We don't want to be audited. No, you got to make sure that they're having simple things that they can do at first. You don't want to overwhelm the child, but at the same time, you have to give them some responsibilities. Otherwise, you're going to have some 7-year-old with a binky still in their mouth holding their blankie, and you haven't given them any responsibilities.
My name's Annie. I'm a fashion student from Essex. I'm 18 and I still suck a dummy.
Succeed in this and you'll have the sense of purpose. So it is very important to make sure you do this balancing act as a parent and giving your child responsibilities. Again, I want you to ask yourself, do you have this sense of initiative? Do you do the things you're supposed to do? Or do you feel this sense of guilt? How long did it take you to hit play in this video? Did you let another day go by without studying or doing that assignment? Did you wake up feeling disgusting? Oh, jeez, I'm so guilty. I should have studied, but instead I did nothing. I've been playing video games all day long and my Hot Pockets and Monster Energy drinks are just piling up. If you have a sense of initiative and you're sitting in a pile full of filth and Hot Pockets and Monster Energy drinks, what do? You clean it up. If you have an assignment due and you have a sense of initiative, what do? You do it. Now, some people ask, well, is it possible to have both? It's a very important question. Yes, we all have a sense of initiative and we all have a sense of guilt. In fact, we all have all of these. We all have a sense of trust, but we also have a sense of mistrust. The idea of one virtue totally eradicating the other virtue is not healthy, and we'll get into this later. But you need to have a sense of mistrust, and you need to have a sense of shame, and you even need to have a sense of guilt, because the more you slack off, the more guilty you feel. But you need to use that guilt as a weapon, because that guilt actually fuels that initiative. Eventually, at some point, you'll say, okay, enough is enough. I gotta do the assignment. I gotta take out this garbage. I gotta clean up myself, etc. But you need to make sure that you have this appropriate balance, that you're more initiative than you are guilt, that you're more trust than you are mistrust, that you are more autonomy than you are shame and doubt. So with that in mind, let's move on, talk about stage 4. How well do you do something? This is the sense of industry versus inferiority. Are you gonna do it? Are you gonna do it? Are you gonna take out that garbage? Are you gonna take out that garbage? Are you gonna hand in that assignment? I did my assignment. It sucks because I kinda suck. You ever do that move where you hand in an assignment but you put it under other people's assignments because you don't want the teacher to see it first? But that shows a sense of inferiority. I don't want you to look at mine because I did a crap job on this crap assignment. Or you gonna slam that paper down saying, boom! Assignment accomplished. I nailed this. I hope you wear a helmet when you read this, prof, because your mind's about to be blown. That's a sense of industry. Industry is not only do you do things, but you do them well. This happens from 6 to 12 years of age, because now you're in school. You don't just get smiley faces and stars anymore. No, now you get grades. Are you going to get that C, that B, or are you going to get that golden A? Well, how do you get a sense of industry? Well, this is the stage of life surrounding the mastery of knowledge and intellectual skills where you are graded. A sense of competence and achievement leads to industry. Getting those A's, feeling that you're growing and learning, but feeling incompetent and unproductive leads to inferiority. I usually don't like doing this, but I'm gonna give you the golden ticket here. Real quick pop psychology. If you want to raise your child to have a sense of not only initiative, but also industry, you need to do what we call scaffolding. It's also known as shaping, as we've learned in operant conditioning. You want to make sure you start small and you slowly grow. For instance, you want to teach your child to clean their room. First thing you do, you tell them, hey, you're old enough to start cleaning your own room. Once they are done cleaning their room, you don't even look at the room. You just ask them, are you done cleaning your room? Okay, cool. Well, let's celebrate. Chuck E. Cheese time. Let's go party. But before we do, let me ask you one question. Is there anything you could have done that would have made the room better? If I look in your room right now, would I see any room for improvement? And you let the child, if they're honest, say, yeah. And you don't be overly harsh. You say, okay, well, where are the differences? Well, I just shoved some things in my closet, etc. Like, okay, cool. We're still gonna celebrate. But next time, don't shove everything in your closet. Next time, straighten your bed a little bit more. Next time, you constantly add on these small improvements when it comes to cleaning the room, but you celebrate every time. And you only celebrate if they've shown that improvement. Don't save the partying for when that room is sparkling clean. You save it for improvement. Every time there's improvement, that gets a congratulations. You need to build off foundation, because if you tell a child they're a failure or they're pathetic or they're stupid or worthless, they will believe you and they will stop doing anything productive. So you need to tell them, hey, there's room for improvement. Also, balancing act, do not patronize. If they said they can do better and they're not showing any improvement, you cannot celebrate that. You have to celebrate improvement. This gives us the strength of competence. And I hope you, listening to this video right now, have a strong sense of competence, that you are capable of doing what another person can do. If you come home right now and you find your kitchen sink is spraying water everywhere, do you believe you can fix the sink? You may think, I don't know how to fix a sink, but do you believe that you can fix a sink? Is there something magical about plumbers that they have in their physiology that makes it that they can do something that you can't do? Having this sense of competence is the belief that if you need to, you can apply yourself and accomplish what needs to be done. And ideally, you're doing that right now. You're becoming more competent in psychology as you're listening to this. Ideally, you're becoming more competent in everything you're trying to do. I don't care who you are, what your intelligence level is, what your physical capabilities are. There are things out there that you can accomplish. And as long as you're growing and improving, that's all anyone can ask. You are not inferior. You are an industrious individual, regardless of where you're from or what you're doing. So please continue striving. You will never know what you can accomplish until you actually try. No longer are we going to talk about parenting. Now you're on your own. And you're on your own starting with adolescence, stage 5, where you learn who the heck you are. We're going to learn more about this at the end of the video of the different stages of identity. But identity versus confusion. When you look in the mirror, do you know who is looking back at you? Do you have a strong sense of who you are? Or are you totally confused as to what you are supposed to be? Developing a sense of one who is and where one is going gives you this ego identity. And remember, ego is just a fancy word for self. Successful resolution leads to a positive identity, a good identity, identity that you like and you enjoy. However, unsuccessful resolution leads to identity confusion or a negative identity. Erikson called this identity crisis. Who am I? Who am I? And this is the first stage in which we have two possible bad outcomes. Because in all the stages previously, it was one good or one bad. Do you have a sense of trust or do you have a sense of mistrust? Stage 2, autonomy or shame and doubt? Stage 3, I feel guilty, or do you have that sense of initiative? Either you have a sense of industry or you have a sense of inferiority. But here, you can have a sense of identity, or you can have a sense of confusion, or you can have an identity. But the problem is, it's a bad identity. You've probably asked yourself at some point, who would do such a thing? There's so many bad things that happen in our world. And you ask, who would do that? There are some people out there that would say, I know who would do that. I would do that. You know why? Because I'm a douchebag. And a douchebag just has to douche. That's who I am. There are some people out there that believe that they are bad people, which is why I enjoy the show The Walking Dead. If you're watching The Walking Dead because you're interested in zombies, you're watching it for the wrong reason. The Walking Dead is interesting because of the characters and the decisions they make and who they are during this zombie apocalypse. And one of my favorite characters is Merle. If you're unfamiliar with the show, Merle is someone who always does wrong. When people are faced with a conflict, a healthy individual thinks, what is the best decision to make here? What can I do that would lead to the best outcomes in this situation? But that's not what Merle says. Oh no. Merle thinks, what is the worst thing I can do here that would piss the most people off? And one of my favorite scenes in Walking Dead is near the end of season 3. And I won't plot spoil, but Merle is in a car on his way to do a very Merle thing. And next to him is a character, Michonne. And Michonne is the only person with whom Merle really has somewhat of a relationship. Michonne basically tells Merle, I know what you're about to do, and you don't have to do it. We can turn back right now. You don't have to. And Merle says, yes, I do. And she says, why? And Merle communicates to her, because I'm Merle. And then he kicks her out of the car. Meaning, according to Merle, the scariest thing is not zombies. The scariest thing isn't doing all those horrible things that Merle does. The scariest thing to him is not doing the Merle thing to do. Why? Because if he doesn't do it, then who is he? He has an identity crisis. Think about your own adolescence. In fact, some of you listening to this right now may be in adolescence, that teenage years up until the age of 25, figuring out who the heck you are. Remember that first day of school where you get on your new kicks and your new backpack and you say to yourself, this year's gonna be different. This year I'm gonna walk like this and I'm gonna talk like this. Yeah, this year it's a whole new me. Sometimes in adolescence, your personality's even seasonal. You behave a certain way during the football season because you're hanging out with the football players or the football fans. And then maybe during basketball season or track season, it's totally different because now you got a whole new bunch of friends that you hang out with. It may be totally temperamental and you're trying things out like new pairs of shoes. And that's a good thing. But eventually, you want to find an identity with which you feel very comfortable. And that way you can get this sense of identity. And once you have that, you have a sense of fidelity. This is the basic strength. Fidelity is a fancy word for loyalty, sincerity, genuineness, and a sense of duty in our relationships with other people. You've heard of infidelity. That's when you're not loyal to your spouse, etc. Here, you're loyal to yourself and who you believe you are. Now, what happens after this? Society tells us, hey, once you know who you are, what are you supposed to do? Well, I'm supposed to go to school. Cool. Why are you going to school? Why are you going to college? So I can figure out who I am and what I'm gonna do with my life. Cool, now that you know what you do with your life, what are you gonna do? Are you gonna find someone else? Someone with whom you can share that life? And that brings in stage six. Stage six in young adulthood, intimacy. And maybe you've heard that expression before, that you can't love someone else until you love yourself. You can't have a sense of intimacy until you have a sense of identity. And I hate telling you this, if you're in a relationship with someone and that person doesn't know who they are or what they want to be, that's a sign they're not really ready for intimacy. Now, what does intimacy mean? A lot of people think it means sex. No, intimacy is simply a time for sharing yourself with another person. Doesn't have to be with a lover, but it typically is. Ow. Can you totally share your true self with someone, lowering those defensive walls? Shields are down. And you totally expose yourself, very vulnerable with this person. Hello, this is who I really am. I'm kind of annoying. I hope you like it. I have bad habits. Haha, it's me. Or do you always have this sense of isolation? That lone wolf, there's only three people that will ever understand me. And that's me, myself, and I. I'm the lone wolf. No one will get me. So capacity to hold commitments with others leads to intimacy. Have you ever heard of a flake? If someone's a flake, what does that mean? It means they don't do what they say. They say, I'll be there, and then they're not there. That's a flake. So according to Erik Erikson, in order for someone to have the capacity to be intimate with someone, they cannot be a flake. So again, I hate asking you this, but if you are in a relationship with a flake, that is really bad news according to Erik Erikson and science! Because research shows that flakes are not good partners because you can't trust anything they say. They're not doing what they're going to do. But if you are able to say what you're going to do and do what you're going to say, then you have a sense of commitment and you are able to be intimate with someone. Failure to establish these commitments leads to this isolation, this feeling of being alone and that it's you against the world. And the basic strength you garner is love. Love is that mutual devotion and shared identity, fusing oneself with another person, where you're you, yes, you're totally you, but you're also this other person. Some people argue, well, that sounds like codependency. Get over yourself. Yes, if you are truly in a loving relationship, your identities are independent and they are intertwined as one beautiful whole. You're not only thinking for yourself, but you're thinking about this other person as well. A lot of people have told me the story that they knew that they were in love. When they had a good day, the thing they look forward to the most was sharing that day with the person with whom they are in love.
Our little project, our company, had a very big night. A very, very big night. But it wasn't complete. It wasn't nearly close to being in the same vicinity as complete. Because I couldn't share it with you. I couldn't hear your voice. Or laugh about it with you. I miss my wife. I love you. You complete me. And I just had...
Shut up. Just shut up. You had me at hello.
And I hope all of you find that great, satisfactory love. But love is work. In research, science has shown love is a conscious decision. If you're waiting around, waiting to just simply fall in love, you have to understand that that takes commitment. It takes intimacy. It takes a willful effort to share yourself with another. It takes effort and work. And I think any successful marriage will tell you exactly that. First comes love, then comes marriage. But then what happens after that?
It's the baby carriage.
This comes in stage 7. Stage 7 is generativity versus stagnation. Again, generativity is a made-up word by Erik Erikson, the root word being generous. It's a time to stop thinking about yourself and thinking about others. Family, friends, and work leads to the sense of contribution to later generations. Now, just like in the last stage, intimacy doesn't have to be with a lover. It could be with a best friend. And generativity doesn't have to come from having children. You could be childless, but still get this sense of generativity by contributing to future generations. If you don't, you may feel stagnant. At some point, you'll get a sense of boredom and meaninglessness. If you want to, you can live a life like a rock star. You don't have to be musically talented to live a life of a rock star. Somewhere going on right now as you're listening to this is a party. And you could go there. And you could have so much fun. You could experiment with drugs, sex, every day, every night, party. You could be a couch surfer going from one person's couch to another. Travel, perhaps even the world, being a roadie for some band. But eventually, you are going to wake up years later and look in the mirror and ask yourself, what do I have to show for all this partying except this venereal disease? And you may think that life has been kind of pointless. You need that sense that your life has a greater meaning outside of your own. Now, children is definitely a strong way to get that. And many parents will agree that a lot of their generativity, a lot of their source of meaning in their life comes from being a parent. And if you succeed, you get this sense of care, a broad concern for others, often manifested in the need to teach another to fill their identity. You become the caregiver, ushering others into their success in these 8 psychosocial stages. And this is in middle adulthood. The last stage, stage 8, happens in late adulthood. You spend a lot more time thinking about death. And when you're faced with death, you look at life and you ask yourself, did I have a good life or did I have a poop life? This is the idea of integrity versus despair. Successful resolution of all the previous stages, garnering all those other basic strengths, leads to a sense of integrity and the ability to see the broad truths and advise those in earlier stages. But if you are short on just one of those stages, just one, you may look back at life and think, it's somehow been incomplete, and you have this bitter sense of helplessness. And I don't want you to have that. I don't want anyone to have that. I want people to believe that they led a good life, which is why this may be the most important thing you ever learn in your life, these 8 psychosocial stages, because you want to be left with the strength of wisdom, a detached concern with the whole of life, and more of a concern for the passing of heritage, this idea life has been good and valuable. If your life was a book, was that book worth reading? Sure, there's some boring chapters in there, but there are some amazing chapters in there that are very educational. Yeah, I made some mistakes. Some mistakes were too fun to make just once, but those mistakes really taught me valuable lessons. I learned, I grew, I lived it, I milked it for everything that it's worth. And now you have the sense of wisdom. Let's be very clear. Just because you're old does not mean that you are wise. And that's Erik Erikson's 8 psychosocial stages. We had trust versus mistrust, autonomy versus doubt and shame, initiative versus guilt, industry versus inferiority. Then on your own, you had to learn who you are with identity versus confusion. Once you know who you are, then you can find someone else with whom you can be intimate, or are you isolated? Then we have generativity versus stagnation, and finally, ego integrity versus that ego despair. Oh no! Those are the 8 psychosocial stages. Thank you so much, Erik Erikson. I will ask myself how I'm doing in each of those stages. If I'm having a really bad day and feeling aimless, I should reflect upon myself and think about these 8 stages. What stage am I currently in? And what am I doing to accomplish that virtue? And if I embrace that virtue, I will find peace not only in that day, but ideally in the days to come. And eventually, when death comes knocking on my door, I hope I can say, thank you, Erikson. That was a life worth living. I accomplished all those strengths. We talked about the basic strengths, and I hope you know them. I hope you remember them. What are they? Hope, will, purpose, competence, fidelity, love, care, wisdom. Boom! Man, right off the top of my head, I got the goods. But we also have basic weaknesses. A basic weakness is a motivating characteristic that derives from the failure of these developmental crises. So if you failed, you may not get a basic strength, you'll get a basic weakness. They're the antithesis of the basic strengths. If you have an unbalance of the resolution of a psychological stage, you suffer from a basic weakness. Remember, we talked about how you do need a balance. You want to have more of a sense of trust than mistrust, but you still need some mistrust. If you're off balance, that is maldevelopment. If you have too much of the good thing, that's maladaptive. Too much of the positive virtue, too much of the positive attitude, that's maladaptive. But if you have too much of the negative, that's known as malignant, kind of like cancer. And both of these fall under the category of maldevelopment. So maladaptive. Too much trust is a bad thing? Yeah. Hey, come into this alleyway. I want to show you my knife. Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. What are you doing with that knife? What are you going to show me? Oh, you want my money? Why? It's my money, I thought. Whoops. I guess I was too trusting. You don't want that to happen. But as we've talked before, the more obvious is the malignant. And this is true for all of these. For instance, let's talk about intimacy versus isolation. It is very important to have that intertwined life, that intimate life with someone. But it's also important that you're capable of having your alone times too. Because if you're not able to be alone, that almost ruins your sense of autonomy. Let's also talk about how it requires one of the basic strengths in order to accomplish the next basic strength. Is it possible to get a sense of intimacy if you don't have a sense of identity? No, because you don't know who you are. How can you share yourself with someone if you don't know who that self is? Is it possible to have a sense of identity if you don't have a sense of industry? No, because if you're not trying your best at something, then you don't know what you potentially can do, which totally leads to you understanding who you are and your capabilities. But will you have a sense of industry if you don't have a sense of initiative? No. If industry is doing things well, you're not doing things well if you're not even doing things. And you're probably not doing anything if you don't believe that you're the master of your own destiny, if you don't have the sense of autonomy, and so on and so forth. You need to have the previous strength before you have the next strength. So if you miss one strength, are you doomed then to always fail these future stages? Here's the good news. No. You can fix stages. Even if you're that child that was neglected and you have a sense of mistrust, you can find someone that will teach you that they are trustworthy, and they will start helping you grow this sense of trust. Maybe you've seen those videos of puppies that don't trust anyone because they've been abused or neglected their entire life, but then one person takes the time to pet them and assure them that's okay, and you see the change like a light switch. You're no different. You can go back and you can fix previously failed stages. But there's some bad news to that as well. The bad news is if you can go back and fix stages, that means you can also go back and destroy stages. Holocaust survivors were found to have succeeded in all the psychological stages, except they were lacking one. Which one were they lacking? Stage one, trust versus mistrust. Why? Why were Holocaust survivors lacking trust? Because their neighbors, friends, totally betrayed them. They were thrown into concentration camps where they saw horrific things. Yeah, that's gonna do something to your sense of trust. You're not gonna be as trustworthy as you once were. And that's probably happened to you too. Maybe at some point in your life, you've been betrayed by a close friend or family member. Susie, what is that in my back? Is that a knife? Did you just stab me in the back? Susie, why? When that happens, are you then doomed not to have wisdom, not to succeed in ego integrity versus despair? No, because again, you can fix it. So even if you go back and damage it, you can still go back and fix it. It's a whole process of learning and growing and adapting. It never stops. So let's talk about Erikson's tools. What did he do with his clients, with his research, in order to come up with this theory? He used play therapy. He watched children play with one another, took notes, and he noticed that the form and intensity of play reveals the aspects of personality that can't be described verbally. Because first of all, you can't really interview children. They're not very verbose. They're not eloquent in their words. They can't explain things as well as an adult can, hopefully. So it's important to watch them play because that's a form of communication. And he understood that. He also did psychohistorical analysis. If he's talking about the lifespan in these 8 psychosocial stages, well, what he wants to do is look at someone's lifespan and apply his theory to make sure it still makes sense. So these are just biographical studies. He used psychosocial stages as the framework to describe the crises. He looked at Gandhi and Martin Luther and George Bernard Shaw and wanted to make sure that his theory applied to all these different people from different cultures, even in different times. Hey, answer is they did. When we research Erikson after the fact, Erikson today, applying the science. So let's talk about the research on trust and security. Well, they wanted to see if babies who had trust were functional later in life, more functional than their counterparts. Well, how do you tell if a baby has a sense of trust? Well, studies correlate trusting behaviors in infants ages 12 to 18 months with behavior higher in curiosity, sociability, and popularity. Think of babies that are smiling and walking over to individuals and playing with things. They just got it going on. They're like, oh, I'm having fun, having a good old time. Now, these babies that showed high trust were more likely to be leaders at games and showed greater sensitivity to the needs of others. And then even later studies have shown if you have trust in childhood, you'll have trust in adulthood. If you don't have that trust, well then, you're not looking so good later in life, and there may be some behavioral problems, even criminally, with the law, etc. Trust is important early on. So right away, we have some evidence that yes, trust is important. So we gave individuals tests to assess their understanding of themselves. And individuals that score high in positive self-identification also reveal trust, autonomy, initiative, all these other previous stages. And we can also find psychohistorical analysis of diaries and letters reveal this evidence as well. That if someone has a healthy first 5 stages, 6 stages, 7 stages, etc., they tend to have a very fulfilling and active life. Whereas if someone has a life that was left unsatisfactory, yeah, there were some things lacking in that psychohistorical analysis. Long story short, there is evidence out there that backs up Erikson. Let's talk more about identity. How do we get a good identity? There's a continuum. It's commitment versus exploration. Commitment is how committed are you to identity? I like this identity. This is me. This is who I'm going to be. I know who I am. I have fidelity for it. I'm going to be this person. Exploration. How many different identities did you try? Were you trying out different identities, like different types of shoes at the shoe store? And the intersection between these two, commitment and exploration, give us 4 different identity statuses. We have identity achievement. This is the healthy one. This is where you've done a lot of exploration and you've decided, you know what? I've tried all these different identities. This is the one that fits the best. I love this identity. Boom, identity achievement. Identity moratorium is when you're still trying out identities, but you haven't committed to any of them. This is a good process to be in before you get to identity achievement. You want to try these different identities, but you don't want to perpetually be trying. The way I remember this, I think of a story named Mort. Mort was a mortician, and Mort the mortician was an identity moratorium. He had this weird thing where when someone would come in dead, he'd read all about their lives and would try to act like that person as they would for the day before he got his next client, if you will, on his mortician slab. So Mort was always trying out these different people because he didn't really know who he was. Mort the mortician was in moratorium. Not sure if that will help you remember what moratorium is, but it's trying out all these different identities. Think of us in adolescence. Foreclosure is when you have no exploration, but you have commitment. And that's no bueno. This is the traditional story of parents telling their child exactly who they are and who they need to be, and the child just being diligent and following orders. You're gonna be a doctor. You're gonna be this. You're gonna be that. Our child does this. Yeah, sir, right away, sir. And you have no exploration of who you wanna be. And then identity diffusion. Well, this is when you haven't really committed and you're not really exploring. You're just tumbleweed blowing through a street. Just rolling with everything, having no idea who you are, not trying new identities, almost without any personality. Aimless drifters engaging in anything that the situation requires, which can lead to extreme behaviors. Now, there is potentially a fifth one, which we previously talked about, and that is you have identity achievement, but it's a bad identity. And this is known as alienated achievement. And it isn't very functional. It's very unhealthy. So hopefully when you look in the mirror, you know who you are, you like who you are, and that person is a healthy individual. Ha ha! The stages of identity also apply to people that are looking for their gender and people that are looking for their sexuality. There are typically different stages they go through, very similar to that when you look at gender identity and sexual orientation. We talk about homosexual identity stages. Sensitization is a stage where you realize like, hey, I kind of like Chad. Chad's really got it going on. He's got those big muscles. I especially like it when his shirt's not on. And there comes identity confusion is the second stage. Like, oh man, I really do like when his shirt's off. Does this mean, am I gay? I don't, oh my goodness. Am I getting aroused by Chad? He looks so good. I don't know. And then third is identity assumption. Like, yeah, you know what? I think I like Chad. I do think I'm going to start experimenting a little bit. Like, hey, Chad, you want to go out sometime? Or maybe try things out a little bit. And then fourth is like, yes, I am gay. I'm here. I'm queer. I'm proud. I'm loud. I enjoy Chad. I enjoy people who look like Chad, and I'm not ashamed of it. And research has shown that people that have gone through these stages and have a strong commitment, they score high on gay identity self-report inventories, also score high on measures of mental and emotional well-being, and express no desire to alter identity or to conceal it from other people. The more in touch with who you are, whether it be gender, your sexuality, or anything else that's under the sun, the more comfortable you are in your own skin, the happier you are as a person. Erik Erikson may have been the king of the identity crisis. Well, I hope you aren't, because I want you to have that good life. And there we are. We're at the end here. Erik Erikson's identity theory. We talked about the life of Erikson and his life of having an identity crisis. We talked about his 8 psychosocial stages. I hope you know them very well, feel comfortable. We talked about the basic weaknesses, maldevelopment, where you can be maladaptive or malignant, having too much of one of the virtues. We also talked about Erikson research, looking at the kids' play theory, but more importantly, that psychohistorical analysis of looking at people's past. And research we've shared says that Erikson had it going on. We know that Erikson and his theory is legit. There's a lot of research that backs up a lot of his claims. I had fun. I hope you did too, because I'm Professor Alan Girding and I love psychology. Don't forget to like, share, subscribe, comment, do whatever you want with this video, and I hope you come back next time for some more I Love Psychology.